Please be seated. As Chancellor of the University, I declare this congregation open for the conferring of degrees by the authority of the Senate and of the Council.
High Sheriff of Rutland, distinguished guests, parents, friends, and graduands. As Vice Chancellor of the University, I am delighted to welcome you all to this degree congregation. It is a celebration for all those who graduate today. We celebrate your many achievements that culminate in the award of a degree from a major international research and teaching-led university. While you have been with us, the university has developed and changed. We are now a community of 21,000 students and 3,500 staff with a turnover of £223 million. We are a big business with higher education at its heart. This academic year, we have been very proud of our achievements. Being named as the Times Higher Education's University of the Year was a splendid start. Becoming a very popular university for undergraduate degree places. Having our new university library opened in December 2008 by Her Majesty the Queen, accompanied by His Royal Highness, the Duke of Edinburgh. And finally, just 2 weeks ago, opening our 8th international sculpture show in our botanic gardens. And I do encourage you to go and visit the show. It's absolutely splendid. Going in is free. The exhibits are a little more expensive. In the league tables, Leicester is in 15th place in the Times Good University Guide and in the top 20 in the Independent and the Sunday Times. Last year, the Independent placed us in the highest position, and after carefully studying the data, I concluded it was the most reliable guide to higher education. This year, I have carefully checked the data again and feel sure that I should recommend to you that the Times is the most reliable guide. Recently, we have commenced a £15 million refurbishment and transformation of the existing Percy G Students' Union building. And we have also launched a new development framework plan, which will provide a context for development over the next 20 years. But among all this success, I know that a major concern for many graduates and their parents in this degree congregation is the global economic crisis and its impact upon graduate employment opportunities. I understand from our student development service that while many of our students have found jobs, this will not be the case for everyone. At this stage in your careers, I would urge you to hold your nerve as new opportunities always present themselves. The degrees that you have obtained are world renowned and will always stand you in good stead in the future, but it is important that you aim to be flexible in relation to future employment. This is the key to success in the current climate. And I would urge you to keep your CVs and personal development plans up to date, to highlight your additional achievements, such as the Leicester Award that many have taken, and keep in touch with our Student Development Service, who are always on hand, in person, on the telephone, or through the website, offering advice and guidance to alumni as well as current students. University Careers Services across the country are also available to all students, so you do not necessarily have to return to Leicester for advice, although we would be delighted to provide you with the information and, of course, to see you. You may also wish to consider alternative routes, such as a year abroad with some employment opportunities, or postgraduate study, for which there are prospectuses in the foyer this morning. Or you may wish to apply for a university internship, a new scheme involving 40 new opportunities launched this week, which will provide work experience and a salary for remaining in the university on one of these opportunities. Another option would be to engage in volunteering, an activity in which 1,000 Leicester students have been involved this year through our student volunteering organisation, Contact, which offers training sessions, social events, and works to give the maximum benefit to people in the local area. During the past academic year, its volunteers have been involved in 420 different projects. They include literacy programmes in schools, working in local hospitals, recycling and conservation projects, helpline projects, and mentoring with the Youth Offending Service. We are very proud of this splendid record. Here, our work never stops. We are creating plans for new research, new teaching programmes and new community links. It all demonstrates we are a dynamic 21st century university that provides high quality research, high quality teaching, and a synergy between the two, alongside meeting our widening participation benchmarks and providing an excellent student experience. All these features of our university lead to a positive institutional ethos in Leicester. But all universities require multi-million pound investments for new buildings, laboratories, classrooms and equipment, and Leicester is no exception. Over the past 3 years, we have invested over £80 million in our estate, using our own funds, grants, loans and also donations. It is therefore essential that government funding alongside our own continues to help transform the university. I hope that you will wish to continue to support your university in many different ways through our Alumni Association. We hope you will keep in touch with the university, and I shall look forward to meeting you at alumni events. Finally, I would like to congratulate you all on the degrees you have obtained. But before I close, I would like to tell you a little bit about what has become known as the Vice Chancellor's competition at degree ceremonies. And the competition involves seeing which faculty can applaud loudest and longest. Now, last year, for the first time in the 9 years I had been here, the medical faculty did not win. And just to give them a helping hand, we put them on first yesterday afternoon. Well, I can tell you it's not an open and shut case this year, and so there's a good opportunity that the law faculty, augmented with some social scientists, might have an excellent chance. So I would like you at this stage to join with me in showing your appreciation to your parents, relatives, friends and sponsors who have supported you through university. So I would now ask the graduating class of 2009 to join me in a round of applause for all those people. You're off to a very good start. So have a really enjoyable day. Applaud your fellow students and all good wishes to you all in your future careers.
Guy Canivet is a French lawyer. That is a simple, straightforward statement, which is also true, the kind of statement to delight the heart of any lawyer. But it is not the whole truth. It is akin to describing Shakespeare as an English playwright. It could be said that Guy Canivet is the French lawyer. Until his retirement in 2007, he was Premier President de la Cour de Cassation, the senior judge in France, holding a position analogous to that of Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of the United States. He now sits on the French Constitutional Court, the highest constitutional authority in the country, and so helps to ensure that the principles and rules of the French Constitution are upheld. He is also a member of the Independent Ethics Committee of the International Olympic Committee, ensuring equity in a wider field than the judiciary. The French inquisitorial system is very different from the English legal system. I say English rather than British, since the Scottish system is different yet again. The Faculty of Law at Leicester teaches on several different jurisdictions, requiring the successful law graduands here today to acquire a very large amount of knowledge. I salute them. Guy Canivet began his career in the French courts in 1967 as an auditeur de justice, an assistant to a juge d'instruction. He was appointed juge d'instruction at Chartres in 1972. The role of the juge d'instruction under the French inquisitorial system of justice is rather different from that of judges in English courts. An English judge effectively acts as a neutral referee between opposing parties. The juge d'instruction and his assistants conduct the investigations in cases of serious crime or in complex civil cases. They are only involved in about 3% of all cases. This role is reflected in the usual translation of the title as examining magistrate. The juge d'instruction hears witnesses and interviews suspects and orders further investigations. His goal is not the prosecution of a particular person, but the determination of the truth, and his duty involves the careful search for both incriminating and exculpatory evidence. This training as an impartial searcher after truth has served Guy Canivet well throughout his later career. Guy Canivet was raised to the Court of Appeal in Paris in 1991 and became Premier President, and that is the senior judge of that court, in 1996. In 1999, he became Premier President of the Cour de Cassation, senior judge of the highest court in France, the Court of Final Appeal in civil and criminal cases. The Premier President is the highest ranking judicial officer in the country and is responsible for court administration and the discipline of judges, as well as judging final appeals. As Chief Justice, if I may so term him, Guy Canivet made an enormous contribution to the independence of the judiciary. He often protected the judicial system and his fellow judges from interference from politicians, including the President of the Republic. He has also staunchly and selflessly supported criminal prosecution against politicians in a number of corruption cases which came before his court. Several such cases involved the immunity from prosecution of the President of the Republic himself, which he opposed. This question was later decided in favour of the President by the Conseil Constitutionnel, which in such a matter was the court of last resort. Guy Canivet has also had a great influence on the French court's acceptance of the decisions of the European Court of Human Rights and has been instrumental in establishing a Europe-wide use of such case law. Throughout his career, Guy Canivet has sought fearlessly to promote, protect, and serve the interests of the French people with total disregard of any possible consequences to himself. He is an outstanding example of that true breed of judge, one who believes in an overriding duty to fulfil the public interest in the administration of justice and to do so with confidence and authority at the highest level. Guy Canivet has had a long and illustrious career as a judge, and he has held the highest positions which a French judge can hold. But that is not all. He is also an active university teacher and a first-rate scholar. For many years, he was a professor at the University Paris 5, René Descartes, and now holds a similar position at the Sorbonne. He has written widely on human rights and the independence of the judiciary, as well as on competition law. In recent years, he has also worked hard on his English and is now capable of delivering erudite lectures to the English judiciary in English. In so doing, he has greatly changed the views of many in the English legal system as to the true nature of French and European law. Fortunately for my audience, I've been able to give this oration in my native and only tongue. To conclude, therefore, I say in English, Mr. Chancellor, on the recommendation of the Senate and the Council, I present Guy Canivet, that you may confer on him the honorary degree of Doctor of Laws.
Sir, I wish you to be an honorary Doctor of Laws. Many, many congratulations. Please take a bow.
Mr. Chancellor, Mr. Vice-Chancellor, Professor, graduate, ladies and gentlemen. It's my honor to be here today in your great university for this beautiful ceremony. As a European citizen, as a lawyer, as a judge, I'm pleased that the opportunity is given to me to pay tribute to the University of Leicester for his outstanding contribution to the knowledge of law, to the knowledge of the human, to the knowledge of the environment in which its actions are developed. Culture and European social sciences owe much to Leicester, who was the university where Norbert Elias was able to continue his work and conduct his seminar on the process of civilization under the chair that you have given to him. No one specialist in political sciences is unaware of the considerable work undertaken by the sociologist Lord Giddens. The new rules of the sociological method teach us that the structure should be conceptualized not only as constraints on the man, but as enabler. From that, the constitutional judges takes a daily new approach of state institution and fundamental freedoms. No one specialist in criminal law and criminal science should not ignore the scientific discoveries of Sir Alec Jeffrey regarding DNA and the impact of DNA testing on criminal investigations. His genius has transformed the relationship in criminal law with the truth. We see that every day. Your law school has been a pioneer in the United Kingdom, offering studying French law and common diploma for students in English and French in partnership with French University, particularly with Strasbourg University. Many excellent French lawyers have benefited from this teaching. These achievements are only one manifestation of the reputation of your university opening for European and European international studies. Another witness of this opening is your Department of European Studies, well known to all researchers, practitioners, and students interested in European law. Allow me to welcome especially the academic staff of all nationalities, among whom I appreciate to find French professors. French students are very lucky to be here. They can even measure and compare their happiness, because I saw that your university has undertaken comparative research on happiness to exist in all countries of the world. I was finally allowed to express personal thanks to Mats Andenas for his outstanding and consistent contribution to the communication between the systems of common law and civil law, for the dialogue of legal cultures, to say my appreciation also for the joint work we have done in this area. Transcendental, in the sense given by Novel Elias, today's ceremony is probably could have been part of the culture of court. This impressive ceremony ultimately allows the civilized expression of feelings that I feel like today, friendship, sympathy, and gratitude. I am very happy and grateful to receive this honor of Doctorate of Law from the University of Leicester. Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm sorry for my awful pronunciation.
The graduands in the Faculty of Law will be presented by the Dean, Professor Bonner. Will all graduands in the faculty please stand?
Mr. Chancellor, I ask you to admit these candidates from the Faculty of Law to the several degrees for which they are presented.
Graduands in the Faculty of Law, by the authority of the Senate, I admit you to the several degrees for which you are presented.
For the degree of Master of Laws in European Law and Integration, Edward Roos. For the degree of Master of Laws in European Union Law Commercial, Katerina Brandisova. Esther Fischer. For the degree of Master of Laws in European Union Law, Social Law and Policy, Sarah Clarkson. Rosemary McAllister Smith. Asta Magnus Dottier. For the degree of Master of Laws in Human Rights, Lucy Mott. For the degree of Master of Laws in Law and Employment Relations, Catherine Danini. Alison Wilmot Miller. For the degree of Master of Laws in Law of Employment Relations, Craig Benison. Charles Boyle. Winner of the New York Chambers Prize, Sally Brett. Julia Burnside.
Congratulations, Julia.
Rachel Dowson. Peter Etherington. Gillian Fairley. Philip Gray. Jonathan Inslee. As a posthumous award, presented to the family of Anthony Jennings. Tracy Leghorn. Julie McClelland. Tim O'Connell. Kishama Srivastava. Mark Taylor. For the degree of Master of Laws in Public International Law, Hainyalka Juhas. For the degree of Bachelor of Laws in Law, Amira Adam. Kazmir Afzal. Afreen Akhtar. Tanvir Akhtar. Maria Alexandru. Katie Allard. Glykaria Andreu. Basiliki Andreu. Sandish Bahia. Germinda Baines. Kieran Baines. Naomi Barnes. Rachel Beard. Fozana Begum. Emma Belcher. Sidoni Bent. Kirsty Berry. Gurdi Buparai. Winner of the Eversheds Commercial Law Prize, James Burdekin. Winner of the May Fund Prize, Matthew Burton. Christy Versio. Edmund Cattle. Archana Trandrasekaran. Urania Haralambus. Philip Charlwood. Zakia Chowdhury. Anthea Christodoulou. Estathios Christofides. Eleni Chrysanthou. Jeremy Clayton. Sophie Cook. Sarah Courtman. Kirsty Cunningham. Rajiv Dalal. Vivian Dapp. Gina Dowd. Winner of the Brian Dodds Memorial Prize and the Morgan Cole Company Law Prize, Shakir Dowd. Charlotte Davis. Winner of the Harvey Ingram Limited Liability Partnership Law of Tort Prize, the Oxford University Press Law Prize, the Herbert Smith Prize, the Mills and Reeves Scholarship, and the Department of Law Prize, Aaron Desborough. Seema Devshi. Jaspreet Dillon. Tejinder Dillon. Andrew Dushantha. Skevi Dionellu. Alpa Divecha. Claire Donner. Tara Doyle. Claire Economou. Despo Efstathiou. Andre Elina. James Ellis. Mark Emery. Luke Everson. Yannick Facy Sinclair. Oluwatoni Fayin Minu. Christopher Feller. Christian Fennick. Mariam Gafar. Janine Gan. Winner of the Eversheds Commercial Law Prize, Gary George. Angelina Gill. Aphrodite Hajipanai. Sonia Hamshaw. Rahan Hanif. Lucas Javieras. Francesca Hayes. Charlotte Hooper. Stephanie Hughes. Melissa Hooray. Winner of the House Percival Prize, Aisha Hussein. Well done. Adana Iloamuanya. Jade Ilott. Criso Volanto Ionu. Ajiri Itimi. Daniel Jackson. Anamika Jagota. Cynthia Jas Ikpeme. Jesse Jones. Winner of the Jan Gradetsky Memorial Prize, Stephen Jones. Haley Jocelyn. Lucia Canarini. Manvia Kaur. Mohsin Khan. Rukia Katun. Jennifer Kitching. Andromache Cleanthus. Alexander Call. Elena Contu. Kyriakos Koutelos. Stephanie Kiriakou. Yaya Leha. Wing Lam. Phoebe Larkin. Oscar Lawrenson. Nusrat Leaktali. Louisa Lemonari. Louise Lisk. Xiao Loy. William Luke. Ibrahim Lunat. Olufunke Makinde. Patrick Malone. Harpinder Mangat. Philippa Marks. Ida Maruti. Havanjit Kaur Mawaha. Haris Mavronikis. Holly Main. Thomas Mead. Sandeep Minhas. Safneet Minhas. Lucy Monaghan. Stephen Moore. Richard Morgan. Nyla Mustafa. Winner of the Jan Gradecki Memorial Prize, the Faculty of Law Prize, and the Jan Gradecki Conflict of Laws Prize, Lloyd Nail. Johuran Nesser. Samantha Odete. Yemi Olaye. Fanny Onufriu. Georgia Papa. Anjali Patel. Bhavisha Patel. Gayatri Patel. Poonam Paul. Winner of the Victoria Fisher Memorial Prize, Karen Peddle. Sarah Phelps. Mary Philippou. Matthew Pickham. Zara Ramkahul. Faraz Raza. Oliver Riley. Eleanor Robinson. Kareen Rose. Alice Rutter. Priskinda Sahota. Tariq Sefu. Elliot Sellers. Sonia Shafiq. Jamal Shah. Sajid Sheikh. Anyi Shialaru. Lukjit Sidhu. Eleni Similidi. Adam Simpson. Thomas Simpson. Olivia Singh. Samantha Singh. Winner of the George Heim Memorial Trust Prize, Jennifer Smith. Winner of the Morgan Cole Landlord Prize, Sally Ann Smith. Despo Socrates. Rupinder Sahal. Leah Soloway. Simon Stone. Michael Stops. Maria Stilianu. Clarice Tagore Reinhold. Xu Lun Tang. Helena Taylor. Emma Thompson. Evangelia Tiki. Melanie Timms. Christos Trifonos. Wendy Sang. Winner of the Roger Benedictus Memorial Prize in Employment Law, the Sweet and Maxwell Prize, and the Clyde and Company Prize in Competition Law, Paul Turner. Anita Tiagi. Javi Videra. Kinjal Vadgama. Elise Wakelin. Jenna Walker. Christopher Welsh. Kate Westley. Sarah Wilkin. Charlotte Willer. Kendra Winter. Lizzie Ragg. Amrina Zaidi. Mohammed Zulkarni.
Adrian Weston is a lawyer who has for many years placed his legal and financial expertise at the service of this university. The conduit for this service from 1999 until 2008 was the University Council, which is the governing body of the university. At council meetings, Adrian chose to sit directly facing the officers of the university, which was useful for fixing them in the eyes when he wished to make a point. The semiotics of his interventions were always a delight to observe. As he spoke, his eyes sparkled and his face was animated by a warm smile. The substance of his words, however, was sometimes a firm corrective and sometimes a very firm word of advice, which was invariably coupled with an offer of assistance. His service to the university ranged from counsel to committees dealing with fundraising, investment, purchasing, the initiation of business, and the development of our estate. His expertise in taxation was also freely given, and that has helped donors to the university to give in tax-efficient ways. Indeed, should any of you wish to donate, I am confident that Adrian would be happy to assist. In his professional life, Adrian Weston was a corporate lawyer with a practice in Leicester. The decision to practice here represented a return to his roots, for Adrian is a son of this city and county. After prep school in Thringston during the war and secondary school thereafter at Ratcliffe-on-the-Reek, he spent 2 years in the Royal Air Force as a pilot officer in fighter control, mostly in Germany, where the RAF played a central role in the Cold War. Thereafter, he decided to train as a lawyer and so read jurisprudence at the Queen's College in Oxford. He had always been a sportsman, but it was at Oxford that one sporting enthusiasm began to edge ahead of the others, hockey. Indeed, it may not be wholly coincidental that when Adrian chose a college, he chose one with a hockey pitch. He played hockey for his college and for his university and continued to play when he returned to Leicestershire, serving the sport in a succession of roles. In the Leicestershire County Hockey Association, he served as captain and secretary in the 1960s, and then as vice president for 34 years, at the end of which he was elected an honorary life member of what had become the Leicestershire and Rutland Hockey Association. At the same time, his geographical range expanded, and he served on the Midland Counties Hockey Association, of which he later became a vice president, and then he was appointed a member of the committee which ran the English Hockey Association. For 6 years, he was executive chairman of the English Hockey Association. Since 1977, he has served as vice president of the Hockey Association and its variously named successors. Within the city and the county, he has served in a broader sporting capacity. First as a chairman of Leicester Sports and Recreation Advisory Council, and as chairman of the Leicestershire Sports and Recreation Advisory Council. We are today honouring Adrian for his services to this university, but his contribution to sport means that we could equally have chosen to honour that sphere of his life instead. Hockey was Adrian's after-hours passion, but during the working week, he practiced law, serving for 41 years at Harvey Ingram, the distinguished Leicester firm, which he had entered as an articled clerk and was eventually to leave as a senior partner. His energy gradually transformed a small practice into the largest and most prominent practice in the city. Adrian began as a generalist and then specialized in the leases of retail shop units and in liquor licensing law. These niches proved too narrow for a man of Adrian's capacious intellect, and so he shifted in the 1970s to corporate work, where he became an important figure in the world of mergers and acquisitions. This migration to commercial law enabled Adrian to develop expertise that was of interest beyond his law practice, and over the course of 25 years, he developed a portfolio of non-executive directorships. He still retains a few of these, notably the Pensions Bank, which is a Leicester-based private bank offering specialist banking services to administrators and trustees of pension schemes, and perhaps of wider interest to the graduating class of Everard's Brewery, which it is to be hoped offers its directors free beer in perpetuity. Adrian Weston has been a great supporter of the city and the county that nourished him. In the education sphere, he served as a decade as a governor for what is now Leicester High School for Girls, and then served for 14 years as a governor of his old school, Ratcliffe College, including 7 years as chairman. Today, however, we single out his service to this university's council. The university can point to many successes in the past decade, but the financial climate that makes the management of universities so demanding could have led us into financial difficulties. Our Vice Chancellor and our Director of Finance were fortunate in being able to draw on the advice of a few wise men and women with competence in these matters. Adrian Weston repeatedly gave the right advice at the right time, and we are all in his debt. His greatest triumph in this sphere was the fundraising for the David Wilson Library, and our pride in that building is in a sense an expression of our gratitude to Adrian, who in significant part made it possible. Mr. Chancellor, on the authority of the Senate and the Council, I present Adrian Robert Weston, that you may confer upon him the degree of Doctor of Laws.
Sir, I admit you to the degree of Doctor of Laws.
Thank you very much.
Chancellor, Vice Chancellor, ladies and gentlemen. My wife is worried because I haven't got my spectacles on, but it's the benefit of 36-point pica. Over the last 10 years, my period with the university, I have watched a progression across this stage of a string of the famous and the distinguished, academics, leaders of business, popular entertainers, sporting heroes, authors, artists, and French judges. It is therefore rather humbling to be invited into their number, and I thank the university for the honour it is bestowing on me, particularly because it completes two circles in my life. Circle one is the New Walk area and to Montfort Hall. When I was a young lad during the Second World War, for goodness sake, I lived at the top of New Walk, number 158. Since it was long before the days of television or computers, children spent great swathes of their time getting into mischief out of doors. And a lot of my time was spent on Victoria Park and in the gardens surrounding this hall. The real attraction of the gardens was that they were forbidden territory. So the game was to get close enough to the park keeper to be seen, and sometimes even chased, but not close enough to get caught. Since it was wartime, the park keeper was about 70, so I really can't claim any credit for not being caught. As I grew older, I came and still come here for concerts, starting with somebody who will not be known to most of the people sitting at the front of the hall, Paul Robeson. Then all the great jazz stars, Basie, Ellington, Bechet, folk and country stars, Pete Seeger, Lonnie Donegan, Tom Paxton, and then, now in my older age, on to famous orchestras, the Berlin, the Concerto Gebouw, the Leipzig, and indeed the London Philharmonia. So to stand here on this stage, to complete the circle in my life. The second circle is the nature of this degree, Doctor of Laws. I have a law degree from a slightly older university than Leicester, the exact status of which I have managed to keep quiet at this university for a long time, but it rhymes with Douglas. It was in the areas of law which I had little relevance for real life. There were, for instance, two papers on Roman law, one in Latin. Just ask yourself how you'd have got on. Then I spent many years in an office at the bottom of New Walk as a practicing lawyer. Since New Walk is an old Roman road, there was always the chance that a Roman soldier would heave into view with a slave in tow. And there I would be, the only lawyer in town who knew how to free him. The fee would have been extortionate, even by lawyer standards. But for some strange reason, I was never called upon to exercise the skill. Now I am retired, but have been welcomed to a more advanced honour in law, and this time I do not even have to pretend that I have studied for it. Circle two is closed. It is a sad fact that for most of my working life, I was only vaguely aware of the university, which slept gently up at the other end of University Road. However, for the last 10 years, it has been a pleasure to see the giant wake from its slumbers and come vigorously to life. Those who have caused that transformation, many of whom who are on this platform today, deserve the highest praise. And those of you who are newly graduated and have participated in the process and lent it your youthful vigour can be proud of your achievements. And as a member of the fundraising committee, I would remind you that in many years' time, when you are in your prosperous 60s and 70s, we shall probably be once more rebuilding the Percy G building, and my successor will be following you up. I wish you all a long, prosperous and interesting life. Thank you very much.
The remaining graduates in the Faculty of Law will be presented by the Dean, Professor Bonner.
For the degree of Bachelor of Laws in Law, European Union, Rebecca Bourne.
Congratulations.
Jamal Deo.
Congratulations.
Alexander Grafe.
Congratulations.
Camille Kochmarchik.
Congratulations.
Natania Notra.
Congratulations.
Kevin Paramore.
Congratulations.
Jyoti Salhan.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Bachelor of Laws in Law International, Krista Campbell.
Congratulations.
Angela McCarthy.
Congratulations.
The winner of the Neil Barrington Memorial Prize, Nicholas Webb.
Congratulations. Well done on your part.
For the degree of Bachelor of Laws in Law with French Law and Language, Cheryl Christie.
Congratulations.
Sarah Cromwell.
Congratulations.
Aaron McCauley.
Congratulations.
Katie McKechnie.
Congratulations.
Edward Nisbet.
Congratulations.
Thelma Onyeka.
Congratulations.
Daniel Pothicary.
Congratulations.
The winner of the Leicestershire Law Society Prize, Kevin Riley.
Congratulations. Well done on the prize.
Laura Richards.
Congratulations.
The winner of the Freeth Cartwright Limited Liability Partnership Law with French Prize, Jennifer Tyson.
Congratulations. Well done on your prize.
Daniel Vokes.
Congratulations.
Sarah Waddingham.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Bachelor of Laws in Law Maîtrise, Nicola Danine.
Congratulations.
Florian Kastler.
Congratulations.
The winner of the Franco-British Lawyer Society LLB Maîtrise Prize, Ariane Lestrade.
Congratulations, well done on your prize.
Elsa Wellerly Godard.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Bachelor of Laws in Law Senior Status, Deirdre Badcock.
Congratulations.
Brian Bate.
Congratulations.
Michael Cabo.
Congratulations.
Tarak Desai.
Congratulations.
Winner of the Herbert Smith Debating Competition Prize, Andrew Dickens.
Congratulations, well done on your prize.
Diana Dukir.
Congratulations.
Ali Khan Esmail.
Congratulations.
Sharif Gobrial.
Congratulations.
Lily Goyal.
Congratulations.
Anu Kieran Clark.
Congratulations.
Alicia Kochekin.
Congratulations.
Savil Majid.
Congratulations.
The winner of the John Holyoake Prize, Laura Mills.
Congratulations. Well done on your prize.
The winner of the Linklaters Prize for the Client Interviewing Competition, Bradley Phillips.
Congratulations, well done on your prize.
Adrienne Rigg.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Bachelor of Laws in Law, Melissa Owusu-Sekere.
Congratulations.
Mr. Vice-Chancellor, I ask you to admit to the several degrees for which they are presented by my faculty those candidates who are absent.
By the authority of the Senate, I admit those candidates who are absent to the several degrees for which they are presented.
The graduates in the Faculty of Social Sciences will be presented by the Dean, Professor Jackson. Will all graduates in the faculty please stand?
Mr. Vice-Chancellor, I ask you to admit these candidates from the Faculty of the Social Sciences to the several degrees for which they are presented.
Graduates in the Faculty of the Social Sciences, by the authority of the Senate, I admit you to the several degrees for which you are presented.
For the degree of Doctor of Social Sciences, Linda Holland.
I admit you to the degree of Doctor of Social Sciences. Many congratulations.
Jill MacDonald.
I admit you to the degree of Doctor of Social Science. Many congratulations.
Christopher Mikalev.
I admit you to the degree of Doctor of Social Science. Many congratulations.
Kirsten Stevens.
I admit you to the degree of Doctor of Social Science. Many congratulations.
Derek Walsh. Mary Williams Prendergast. For the degree of Master of Science in Human Resource Development and Performance Management, Charmaine Sela. For the degree of Master of Science in Human Resource Management and Development, Lubna Chowdhury. Konstantinos Kostouris.
Congratulations.
David Flaherty.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Master of Science in Industrial Relations and Human Resources, Thomas Woods.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Master of Science in Training, Patricia Rodwell.
For the degree of Master of Science in Training and Human Resource Management, Joseph Abella. Etienne Bartolo. Doreen Gustave. Gan Lee. Winner of the David Ashton Prize, Lindsay Rich. Hong Wang. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, I ask you to admit to the several degrees for which they are presented by my faculty those candidates who are absent.
By the authority of the Senate, I admit those candidates who are absent to the several degrees for which they are presented.
High Sheriff of Rutland, distinguished guests, parents, families, and above all, graduates of the University of Leicester. Can I, first of all, echo the Vice-Chancellor's opening words and offer a very warm welcome to all of you here today to the University of Leicester. For me as Chancellor, it's always heartwarming to come into this great hall and to see parents, families, friends, and supporters here, to see the pride in your faces and the loudness of your cheering at the achievements of your families and friends here in the body of the hall. I will therefore be brief because, above all, today is a day of celebration for you, the graduates of the university, and I do not want to stand between you and possibly the odd bottle or two that will be consumed at lunchtime. However, may I begin by adding to the splendid words of our orators this morning and offer my own warm personal congratulations to our two new honorary doctors of law, Guy Canivet and Adrian Weston. Guy, that someone as senior as you in the French judicial system should accept our award and be here today does us great honor, sir, and we thank you for it. Moreover, your presence here, in the presence of these young law graduates, many of whom have studied, as you've seen, European and indeed even French law, embodies a very important principle: that justice, freedom, and the rule of law transcend national boundaries and are a right of humankind the world over, and that what unites us is not the differences in our legal systems, but these fundamental principles. Adrian, your long and very distinguished career here in Leicester demonstrates to all of our graduates what law can do when it is put to the use and the service of society. We're also very deeply grateful to all you have done for us over the last decade here at the University of Leicester. You both do us great honor in accepting our degrees, and I reiterate my warm welcome to you both here as graduates of this university. But now turning to all of you, it is true, I'm afraid to say, that as you leave here today clutching that degree certificate, it's just the start of the journey into whatever aspect of the legal or other profession you choose as your career destination. Turning first of all to our young lawyers here today, whether you become barristers or solicitors or enter the judiciary, or whether you seek your careers in perhaps the commercial areas of law and the city, you will nevertheless be bound by one common factor. I mentioned in the context of Guy Canivet a moment or two ago this concept that lay people like me use of the rule of law, so difficult to define and yet so instinctively understood by all of us. And the world is strewn with all too many examples where that rule of law is not upheld. So we look to you, the new generation of lawyers, to take this responsibility seriously. We, the rest of us in society, must know that we can depend on you to uphold that rule of law. Now, it may well be, as I've just said, that some of you will indeed see the lure of the financial markets in the City of London as all too tempting, fraught though those markets may be at the present time. I reminded the law graduates last year of Charles Dickens' observation in Bleak House that the one great principle of the English law is to make business for itself. You might do well to remember that. Indeed, on Monday this week, I spent the day in the company of city lawyers in London on a rights issue for a public company on a board in which I sit. And yes, indeed, the legal fees were of a telephone book proportion. Now, before you reach for your mobile phones to apply to those internships at Clifford Chance or whoever else, let me just tell you of the weekends, the hours, the evenings, and the nights in recent months that the law team has worked. The workman is worthy of his hire. They are indispensable. And once again, in the commercial markets, we, the laity, must be able to depend on you as the defenders of truth and freedom in society. But turning, if I may, briefly to those of you who have graduated in degrees associated with human resources and the labour market. Nowhere, of course, is the turmoil which has originated in the financial markets felt more keenly than in the labour markets of the world. Literally millions, millions of lives have been affected by the crisis which is still ongoing. So you face particular and serious challenges as you set out on your degrees, on your careers, following your degrees. Someday, of course, hopefully soon, the world's economies will recover from this current downturn. But until then, the sheer human scale of what we are experiencing will dominate our thinking. I wish you well in helping to tackle this enormous task in what you do next. So you, all of you, leave this hall today as alumni and alumni of the University of Leicester. As the Vice Chancellor has already said, we will take great pleasure in watching your careers as they unfold. We will take great pride in following your achievements as graduates of this university. Do stay in touch with us, come back and see us, and above all, I wish you a healthy and happy life in the years to come. Thank you. I now declare this congregation closed.